Good evening. I'm Tanya Tetlow, your brand new president of Fordham University, and I get the pleasure of just welcoming everyone and thanking the people who made this possible. First and foremost, our panelists, whom the dean will introduce in a moment, but especially the audience for coming. We have undergraduate students, grad students, faculty, staff, alumni, board members, and other guests. I want to thank the Gabelli Center for Global Security Analysis, the Museum of American Finance, and the CFA Society of New York for organizing this event, and we are so proud to host it here at Fordham. The Financial Issues Forum is a partnership between all of those institutions and part of the events they put on every year. And so we are thrilled to make this a vibrant part of our intellectual life and our campus life and to get to think about the issues that matter most to our economy and to our future. So let me pass it on to our newly appointed Dean of the Gabelli School, Lurzan Aksoy.
Thank you so much, President Tetlow, and good evening. Thank you all for attending this inaugural event of the Financial Issues Forum, the enduring value of Roger Murray. Tonight, we are joined by two industry giants, our esteemed alumnus, Mario Gabelli, CEO of GAMCO, and Leon Cooperman, who's joining via Zoom, founder of Omega Advisors and recently Omega Family Office. Both of these highly respected and successful investors rose from humble beginnings in the Bronx to make their fortunes on Wall Street. And both were greatly influenced by Roger Murray, who was their professor at Columbia University. A financial professional, economist, advisor, and member of Congress, an educator, Murray was successor to the legendary Benjamin Graham, who was a professor of securities analysis at Columbia. He was a critical figure in the history of value investing and taught and mentored generations of students who went on to have highly successful careers, including Mario Gabelli and Leon Cooperman, as well as Jim Kelly, the director of the Gabelli Center for Global Security Analysis and a senior lecturer in finance at the Gabelli School of Business. While so much has changed since Roger Murray's time at Columbia, his investment principles remain unchanged. And they form the basis of the discussion tonight, which focuses on a new book written by Paul Johnson, who is the founding partner of Nicusa Investment Advisors and an adjunct professor here at the Gabelli School of Business. And Paul Sonkin, who was a co-portfolio manager for GAMCO's TETON Westwood Mighty Mites Fund. The book sheds light on the enduring value of Murray and the tremendous impact on the development of pension funds in the US and on so many individuals through his remarkable lectures and philosophy of investing. When I read the book, I was fascinated by its content, and I am greatly looking forward to hearing from those professional careers who were so deeply influenced by his teachings. Thank you all for participating in this discussion and for bringing Roger Murray's philosophy of investing to life for the next generation.
Pourquoi pas?
Timing and investing is everything, right? And the timing of tonight is weirdly prescient. So 30 years ago this week, Roger Murray was 82 years old, and he stood before a sellout room, and he lectured for 90 minutes on value investing. 30 years ago this week. Actually, technically, it would have been the third lecture of four this week, because he started on the 22nd of January was the first lecture. And then the following week, the second. So the third would technically have been this week, and he did one more. He did four 90-minute lectures, standing the whole time without a single note. How did that set of events happen? Why did you bring Roger Murray back in 93?
If you're asking me why, it was not complicated, okay? And we'll go back. Lee and I were classmates at Columbia. We'll go into the, you know, how we had to fight for the one pay phone to call our broker. We decided to neutralize that by having the same broker. But independent of that, what we wound up doing was the following. We were able to create videos on DVDs. We had something for Roger prior to that, and we said, look, let's capture him. So here's Roger Murray, comes down in the middle of winter, and we are having a very warm winter in New York, but a very cold winter, with a sports jacket on, a knapsack, walking from Grand Central Station to what is called the Museum of Television and Radio, Paley Center, on 52nd Street, and gets up for 90 minutes. But the concept was to memorialize it for a long period of time for the future generations, for everyone, everyone in this room to understand the greatness of what a professor can do for you, the current ones at Fordham, the current ones in Adelaide, or wherever you're going to school, and how they have an impact on your life. And so that's why we did it.
Yeah, the event you referred to is in 88. They published this book, Paul, if you... So this is the
He's referring to this book, which he's giving away for free, so...
Right. This one copy, which Paul owns, we're giving away for free. So Roger, this is the fifth edition of Security Analysis, gets published in 88, and you and Lee and Art Sandberg sponsor an event, the Lotus Club, where you bring Roger back in honor of the book. And I assume that helped trigger the idea for the 93 event.
Yes.
Good.
I do not recall, Counselor. Yes, I got it.
Just say yes, it would be
great.
Yes,
it would be great.
Now, I'm going to start with a great quote of Rogers, and you referred to that, very short. The greatest reward for an educator is through the success of his students. So in that sense, we have three of his students who have been very successful, so we'd have to give Roger an A-plus for being a professor.
I would say that the influence of a professor lasts for eternity, and that's why everyone here that teaches and all of the students, we have to applaud that process in the free market system where you can speak whatever you want, say whatever you want at any time you want. So I'll let Lee jump in and see what he wants to say.
I don't know if the audience understands the professor's background. I thought maybe I'd share with the group a lot of his curriculum vitae. You know, he's a distinguished alumnus award from the Collegiate School. He graduated the Phillips Academy in Andover in 1928. He got a BA from Yale University in 1932. He got a PhD in 1942 from New York University. And he also was a recipient of an Alumni Achievement Award in 1970. He has a law degree from Hope College in 1960. He has an honorary in professional societies. He's a member of Phi Beta Kappa, he graduated cum laude, he's a member of Beta Gamma Sigma, and the guy had all sorts of awards. And I think, you know, when you go to business school, a lot of times you get these academic professors that have no real business experience. This man was a practitioner. He understood what he was doing, you know. He built a career as a security analyst, and he imparted that knowledge to us and the importance of, you know, fundamental knowledge. And so that was, I think, the most lasting impact on me. I tell a story often. You know, if you go to the original book in Security Analysis by Graham and Dodd, it is a two-page exhibit of 20 different ratios which he advocated that you should look at over a period of 10 years. Because, you know, return on equity, growth rates, return on capital, things like that are a measure of management and their performance and their competitive position in their industry. So in 1965, Mario, I think this is going back now, with this is 50, 60 odd years ago, we were students of the professor and we had to write a term paper, and I selected a contrasting of Burlington Industries and J.P. Stevens. I'm still around, but J.P. Stevens and Burlington Industries are no longer publicly held. And I had 10 years of 20 different ratios, so there's 200 numbers in an exhibit, and the professor found one transposition in one number circled when he returned the paper to me. I got an A plus, but you know, it's just amazing to me that he would find one transposition in 200 statistics. which shows you the kind of person he was in terms of his commitment to detail, his understanding of the subject matter. And he had a very profound influence on Mario and myself. And I know it's not right. You know, Mario talks about PhDs as being poor, hungry, and driven. Or, you know, more recently, Papa has dough. I never would have got into Goldman Sachs from Hunter College. Not that it's right. I'm the same guy. But the MBA I got from Columbia and the education I got from Roger Murray opened the door to a 25-year career at Goldman Sachs, which you know, stood me in good stead. So he was a professional.
Give a little background. Roger Murray graduates from Yale in 1932. And you can imagine in 1932, there are not a lot of jobs on Wall Street. He lands a job at Bankers Trust. In 1929, Bankers Trust had hired 30 undergraduates to start. In 1932, they hired two. Roger Murray was one of them. He then spent the next 24 years at Bankers Trust. And within a couple of months of being there, he fell in love with investing. And that was his passion his entire life. And he retired in 1956, where he became originally an adjunct professor at Columbia Business School. And he worked for, he got hired by the new dean. Ben Graham had started teaching at Columbia in 1927. And in 1956, he announced he was going to retire. And so the thought was, who was going to take over Ben's class, the most famous investing class? And it was clear Roger was probably the only person qualified. So he started teaching, he took Ben's class in spring of 1956, started teaching in 1957. And he retired in 1977, 21 years later. So this is an individual, as Lee said, who had tremendous success on Wall Street as an investor before he stepped into the classroom. He always wanted to be a
retirement equities fund, if I recall correctly, did he not?
I'm sorry?
Did he manage and run college retirement equities fund? Yeah.
Right. After he started being a professor, he got lured away by Kraft to start their equity portfolio. He was one of the original architects of the variable annuity. Up to that point, everything was a fixed annuity, and they wanted a variable annuity to fight the inflation. And so he worked with Kraft on that, and then he came in and he built their equity division.
He was a very hip guy, but I wondered what he would be thinking about the current investment environment.
Well, that's what I would love to know.
I don't want to give you my view as representative of Roger Murray's view, because who the hell knows? He was a very hip guy. He wrote an article that was published in the series of books for the CFA course called Institutional V. We hypothesized as the market became more institutionalized, institutions became more dominant, that the market would have more violent moves up and down because of the transmission of information being so immediate. But I think some of the craziness going on now with these meme stocks and stuff like that, there's now daily options. Options that expire on a daily basis. It's like gambling. Yeah. You know, I can't identify the right company, let alone the right time frame that's going to move. And so I think, you know, the whole market structure has been destroyed, and in my opinion, you know, when Mario and I graduated from Columbia, we went to Wall Street. Wall Street traded stocks for 50, 60 cents a share, and the Volcker Rule didn't exist. Now, between commissions being non-existent and the Volcker Rule, the brokers can't afford legally or financially to stabilize markets. Secondly, back 50 years ago, the specialist system did 80% of the volume on the New York Stock Exchange. Today, 80% of the volume is off-board in dark pools. So the specialists are not in a position to stabilize markets. Third observation is that we eliminated the uptick rule in 2007. They eliminated the uptick rule. The uptick rule was enacted basically to stabilize markets coming out of the abuses of the Great Depression. And when they eliminated the uptick rule, that gave rise to all these high-frequency quantitative traders that know nothing about value, they know nothing about price. So they pushed the market excessively in both directions. And it's up to Mario and I to maintain our sanity and take advantage of those mispricings. It's not easy, let me tell you, it's not easy. But, you know, it's easier for me than Mario because I don't have any clients anymore. You know, my career, I spent 25 years with Goldman Sachs, 28 years running Omega. In 2018, I gave everybody back their money and I became a family office. So like I say, I'm like Hyman Roth in Godfather 2. Right before they shot him at the airport, he simply said, I'm a retired executive living on a pension. I'm a retired money manager living on investment income. The bad news is I no longer earn what Mario and people like that earn. The good news, I have no pressure because I'm running my own money. I happen to be a guy like Mario who's taking a giving pledge, and I tend to give away all my money. So I want to make money for two reasons. One reason is, if you make money, it means you're right, and I have I'm arrogant like everybody else. I want to be right. Okay. And second, I want to give away more money. One of the guys I have great admiration for is Ken Langone, and my only envy of him is he has more money to give away. So I like to make money in the market to have more money to give away to help people like the students that are probably in the audience right now. But I don't know, I think you would probably...
Hey, Leah, before you continue, and we want more of that as the students ask the questions about what were the ingredients of your success from that class of 1966 or 7, whenever we took Murray, how that motivated you to become in the research department at Goldman, the head of research department at Goldman, the head of the asset management, traveling globally. But what I'd like to do is to show what Roger Murray looked like. Right. Maybe we can start off by doing that. What I did is I condensed a couple of clips. Each one of these lectures was 120 minutes. And as Paul just indicated, he got up there and had no notes, and boom, 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 and it was terrific. So
let me set the stage for half a second. So the first introduction you're going to have is from Mayor Felberg. Mayor Felberg was the dean of Columbia Business School at the time, and he did the introduction to the third lecture that Roger Murray gave. You'll see that. And going to the lecture, Dean Felberg convinced a young professor recently hired by Columbia Business School by the name of Bruce Greenwald to attend the lecture. And Bruce was so blown away by Roger's presentation that he convinced Roger to come back to teach, and this is in the fall of 93. And out of that course, they launched the value investing program at Columbia Business School, which is now, Bruce retired in 2018 after 25 years, and now we have another 4 years, so almost 30 years since that event. And if the series of events hadn't, if Roger hadn't been published this book, Mario and Lee hadn't sponsored the event in 88, then the lectures in 93. If Felberg hadn't dragged Greenwald to the lecture, we might not have what we have today. So the series of events is pretty cool. So Felberg's going to do the introduction.
Yeah, but let me hitchhike on that comment. Bruce Greenwald wanted to get and help bring value investing to Fordham. And Kelly said, what a great idea, and that's why value investing is alive and flourishing at Fordham, because of Greenwald. So, to connect the dots, and that's how it works, and we can go into this as to what the future is about, but that's the past.
You had a little bit to do with it, though.
What?
You had a little bit to do with it.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna hijack. What'd you say? Hijack that comment?
You could do anything you want, but I'd like to roll the film.
Just one more thing. 10 years ago, Mr. Gabelli gave a little dough to the school, and they launched something called the Gabelli Center for Global Security Analysis, which Jim Kelly runs. So you can see that this thing winds through. Enough of all of that. Roll the film, as they say.
Gabelli Asset Management Company is privileged to have been the sponsor of a series of lectures by Roger F. Murray. Dr. Murray is the S. Sloan Colt Professor Emeritus of Banking and Finance at the Columbia University Graduate School of Business. He is also the co-author of the fifth edition of Graham and Dodd's Security Analysis. The first edition, published 60 years ago, laid the groundwork for modern security analysis. These lectures took place in New York City at the Museum of Television and Radio on four consecutive Fridays in January and February of 1993. Each lecture lasts approximately 90 minutes. The topic of the first lecture is value versus price. The first speaker is Mario J. Gabelli, Chief Investment Officer of Gabelli Asset Management Company.
Thank you, Mario. I mean, for us, it's the Mario Gabellis and the Roger Murrays, in fact, that in many ways constitute the spark of the Columbia Business School. My purpose today is to briefly introduce Roger Murray to this audience and obviously to the tape that is being made of this morning's presentation. Professor Murray is in large part responsible for the fact that for over half a century, the principles of Graham and Dodd and value investing have been an important part of the Columbia Business School tradition. Mario's sponsorship of this lecture series is another link in this chain, and the Columbia Business School students, alumni, quite a few of whom are here today and work with Mario, and faculty who are here today, are also testimony to the incredible viability and vitality of the value investing approach. Professor Emeritus Roger F. Murray joined the school in 1956. He first served as Associate Dean and Professor of Finance, and subsequently became the first S. Sloan Colt Professor of Banking and Finance. In one of many demonstrations of the desire of those who know Roger to honor him, the professorship was sponsored by Bankers Trust, where he had previously held a senior position. Taking over the security analysis seminar from Ben Graham, he also taught classes and supervised doctoral students in three major areas: security analysis, portfolio management, and capital markets. During his extraordinarily productive career with the school, Professor Murray was respected by all his colleagues, students, and administration as an instructor, as a faculty member, and as a friend. Among the many honors bestowed upon him is a special tribute to Professor Murray's dedication as a teacher and as a mentor. Four former students from the class of 1967, including Mario Gabelli, made a gift to the Columbia Business School last year to name the large lecture hall in Eurus Hall in Roger Murray's honor. As one successful prodigy remarked, and I quote, "Professor Murray was able to bring to us an intellectual approach to life, and that in itself was a real inspiration to people in the 1960s and those before and those who were lucky enough to be with him." Please join me in welcoming Roger F. Murray.
What I'm going to try and do in this series is to take a look at some of those basic concepts that we all have in mind, and we all think in varying degrees that we apply in the discipline of security selection, security analysis. It's interesting when we go back to our roots in our thinking about these subjects that we find sometimes there's more there than we had really realized lately. So this morning I'm going to address the question of intrinsic value. I think that's the Graham and Dodd expression. I think they...
Professor Murray in action. Yeah, I think, Mario, one of the things I'm most fascinated by is you really have to transport back at the time. Because when you guys were students, this is always a little weird to think about, but there were no computers. There was no Excel. Everything was done, written down on paper. As Lee just talked about,
no
all the ratios.
No 10Ks, no 8Ks.
Oh, come on. I had an abacus.
Advancing.
And then we went to a slide rule.
Right? No internet, no Edgar database, no cell phones, no call transcripts, no Bloomberg, no CapIQ, no online data services, and a lot of accounting irregularities. And yet the principles still hold. I mean, the technology has evolved. As Lee said, the market structure's changed dramatically. The tools have changed. Everybody has all the information now at their fingertips, but the original concepts are still basically the same, all the way back to Graham. Is that fair to say?
Well, I don't disagree with that. And, you know, however, if you think about the 1930s, which were only 90 years ago, and it's 100 a few months ago, think about what happened. You couldn't get data, and stocks were, so you had to go to Washington, D.C. to get data that was filed. You had to go to microfiche. So if you could buy a stock that had $10 million of cash, $8 million of receivables that were money good because they came from quality, whatever it was quality at the time, you know, you did an analysis and you figured out what it was worth. And so if you could buy it at net-net, that is the net intrinsic value of the business, and then it could grow, that's a home run. So then fast forward, you know, what's changed? What's changed is we've gone from a manufacturing world to a service economy. The United States is probably 80% services there. Maybe you have a better number. And so, you know, but the same ideas work. A good business, and what's the valuation? What price do I pay for the growth rate? And Lee can hitchhike on this and, you know, look at the interest rates and the impact that has.
The professor popularized the concept of intrinsic value. He hypothesized that, you know, there's an intrinsic value for every security, and the job of the security analyst is to identify when it's above intrinsic value and the hedge funds can short it, or when it's below intrinsic value, you buy with the hope of appreciation and security. And he did it through diligence. I remember he pokes in front of technical analysis where some technician was, you know, very positive in the stock. If it broke above, if it stayed above a certain level, and the professor says they stay above that level because I got a buy order in to buy as much stock as I could buy at that price. So, you know, a technician is a lazy man's fundamentalist. You know, he basically was 3 yards in a cloud of dust. You know, was pulling apart companies, studying them, and not using a Ouija board. And like I said, you know, we're popularizing the concept of intrinsic value.
But I think you have to add one more layer to that, because it's easy to say buy, determine the intrinsic value, and then buy, of course, below that. But I think Roger, one of Roger's huge contribution, pushback if you disagree, is the discipline required to doing that well. And certainly every time I've heard you talk about, you like people, you know, a lot of people hire for 9 to 5 and you hire from 5 to 9.
No, I'll work from 5 to 9, and unfortunately the ones I'm hiring today want to work from 9 to 5. And we got a real dichotomy here. I remember the concept, if you want to win, just work from 5 to 9. Let everybody else work from 9 to 5. Oh, come on, relax. I don't pay for overtime, trust me.
But I think Roger was, everything I read, I didn't have the pleasure to meet him or hear him speak directly, but everything I read was discipline, do the work, do the analysis, double check. Ask yourself when you're looking at the ratios, are the numbers comparable? Did something change in the tax law? Did something change in the accounting? Did they change their accounting policies to make sure you're looking at it? And you wanted to look at that history. You wanted to understand really the business in depth. Certainly Buffett's the same way, right? He's read the same annual reports for 50 years. It's just understanding the business. And everything I read was Roger was very disciplined about that. Is that fair?
I would agree, and I was in accounting. I've talked to a bunch of students from Adelaide, and they were accounting majors, like 6 out of the 8 I saw outside. I was an accounting major. I understand cost accounting, but that's not what brought me to the passion of being an investor. It was Roger Murray who said, this is how you take that tool and apply it. You know, I started buying stocks when I was 13 after I was caddying. But basically what happens is the following. You read a report of a company. Let's take something as simple as a farm equipment, John Deere. But before you start doing that, you already understand how much is cash flow from livestock, how much is from commodities, what's happening to the global marketplace with regards to food, fuel, and energy. You'll understand the characteristics of the farmer. You understand the fact that people 100 years ago, well, it was now almost 130 years ago, 80% of the world. Farming, and then today it's probably 3% of the population of the United States going down at an accelerating rate. So then you start reading the annual reports, and you do what you said, and that is you, the John Deere annual report. You start off, you got the dynamics of we start with the balance sheet, the P&L, the cash flow, and the footnotes, and then what we look at is who are the competitors. Who on the world is doing what is going on? Secondly, what is the future like? Can they do farming with robots? If I have a 20,000-acre farm, that's 30,000 hectares, or 50,000 hectares, you know, I think I know the fields. And the only thing I worry about is some animal, because if anybody else is trespassing, so are they. I shouldn't say this. The tractor hits the wrong object. You know, that's not relevant. So yes, That's the intensity and focus. And then you have to think about, what price am I paying for this? Where's it going to be in 5 years? And then what Lee pointed out before, you got the mechanics of the market that have changed. The uptick rules means that when somebody, in order to short a stock, you have to have it go up a tick, an eighth or a quarter or a dime or a nickel before you can short it. And they eliminated that so they can keep hitting the stock all the way down, which accelerates movements on a downside. And so, you know, we have to be aware of that, those technical dynamics. And you see that every day, including today.
One thing I would say about Roger Murray is he, in my view, he epitomized the old expression, you have to love what you do and do what you love. You know, he didn't work at this. He lived this. He loved what he did. I don't think he ever looked like he was going to work. I think he just enjoyed what he was doing. He enjoyed helping young people like Mario and myself, you know, learn the business. And I tell all the young people today, the only way to be successful is to do what you love and love what you do. You can't work as hard. You know, Mario and I, you know, even I'm 80 years old, Mario's 80 years old, you know, when I was working, I got in the office at 6:45 in the morning and I was at every night of the week. Now, married 58 years, same woman, and basically we would date on the weekends. During the week, I was totally business.
Jim, you want to go ahead?
Yeah, well, you know, back in that era, there was much more emphasis by Murray on the balance sheet as well as just the income statement. It was you'd study all the financial statements, and look for mispriced assets, and right today the emphasis is much more just on the income statement and projecting earnings. And back then it was more balanced.
Well, I'm going to ask Lee. He said he got an A plus on that paper. Were you doing the balance sheet and the income statement?
I did everything.
You did everything.
Yeah,
I did the 10 years of ratios on 20 different ratios. I don't have the book in front of me. I'm in Florida and the book is in New Jersey. Basically, you did everything. Today is the last quarter. You know, they don't have any long-term vision. It's a very, very performance-oriented, very short-term orientation.
Yeah,
you asked the question before, Mario, which I would share with the audience. You know, you have your own answer, but you know, people ask me, what do I attribute my success to? I tell the youngsters in the audience, it's hard work, it's luck, and it's intuition. You gotta use intuition. So I give you two examples of intuition. I don't think hard work and luck requires any explanation. Okay, intuition. So back in the 60s, if you finished your major and minor in college in 3 years, you were allowed to count your first year of medical or dental school towards your fourth year of college and get a separate degree. So in the summer of 1963, I took physical chemistry at the University of Pennsylvania Summer School, that knocked off my major, and I enrolled in the University of Pennsylvania School of Dentistry. And after 8 days, now you're all gonna laugh, after 8 days, I started to wonder if I was pushing myself in a direction I was fully committed. And it was a very traumatic time in my life because I paid room and board and tuition for a year. All my friends knew I was off at dental school. My dad, may rest in peace, was walking around saying my son's a dentist. And I had to go to the dean of the dental school and tell him I want to go back to undergraduate school and finish off my fourth year unencumbered by any decisions and then make a decision in the fullness of time. The only guy that understood the trauma I was going through was Clint T. Nygren, who's deceased. He was the dean of Hunter College and he had to approve my matriculating back into Hunter in the Bronx. And he said, very courageous decision. Of course, you can come back. Well, when I went back, I had nothing but electives available, and I took 10 courses in economics, got 10 A's, never looked back. I found what interested me. And I got better as I got older, as I focused down on what interested me. So that's intuition. You know, I know a lot of people that maybe complete law school or complete medical school and don't want to be doctors or lawyers. They want to be something else. The second example of intuition, you know, when Mario and I were interviewing for a job, you know, the kids today are so much smarter than we were. You know, I had 16 job offers. You know, I was straight A's in finance. I had a 6-month-old child while I was in school. I knew what I wanted to do. I was Beta Gamma Sigma. I was Wall Street Journal Student Achievement Award and had a very focused interest. And the biggest challenge I had back in the 60s when I was interviewing for a job is remembering if I was talking to Exxon, when my resume read, want position on financial staff of major multinational corporation, we're talking to the Goldman Sachs of the world where I said I want a position in investment research department. my ladder was my real interest, but, you know, I had to cover my bases. And so, you know, I'm very anal. I was told to be on this call at 4:50. I was on this call at 4:50. I got a job offer from Goldman. I was totally broke. It was one of the few times in my life that I passed a deadline without acting. And this, again, is another example of intuition. So I got a call from the fellow who made me the job offer, Bob Danforth, who's now deceased. He said, Lee, we're disappointed we haven't heard from you. I said, Bob, let me be honest with you. I'm totally broke. I have no money. I got a student loan to repay. They were not forgiving student loans back in the 60s. But I got four job offers with more money, but I liked everybody I met at Goldman. And I was very familiar with the Union Carbide compound interest tables. The offer was 12.5. I said, can I make $25,000 a year in 5 years? And he said to me, if you work hard and keep your nose clean, I think you could do it. He says, okay, I'm coming. And guess what? Goldman was the only firm in 150 years that didn't change their name. And I was made a partner in 1976, I think it was, when the firm had a record year of earning $40 million. And when I retired, they earned $1.8 billion. And I was there for the whole run. So, you know, you got to have good intuition. And that's got to prove, that's going to prove things out. And you got to work hard. It's not easy. You know, there's a lot more competition out there than there used to be. And there are a lot of smart kids. You got to be able to play a violin standing on your head and be straight A's. And you maybe have a shot to get into a good school.
All right, I'm going to embarrass you. You're quoted as saying...
Again?
Yes. When I went to Fordham, I had some great professors teaching finance, but it wasn't until I met Roger Murray at Columbia that they saw the sun, the moon, and the stars align themselves and knew this, investment manager, is what I wanted to do. So you had started investing when you were 13, and you went to business school presumably after being 13.
I'm not disclosing anything, but go ahead. Let's make the assumption that I went to business school after 13.
Okay, so somewhere you had been investing for a while, loved it, at a young kid.
Well, that's a matter very complicated. Look, I used to hitchhike from the Bronx up to a golf course in Westchester County, which is about 25 miles away. And by the way, as an aside, the pro, his name was Whitey Boyd, and he had a son, two sons. One was John Boyd. John Boyd had a daughter by the name of Angelina Jolie. So I used to caddy for him. So think about that. But independent of that, I'd stay around late because I could get back to New York and the Bronx on my own. And individuals would come up and play golf at nine holes in the late afternoon. And I figured out what they did. They were what they called specialists on the floor of the New York Stock Exchange. They would talk about stocks. And that's how I got excited about it. So as a result of that, I would read the local newspapers. I didn't have the tape and stuff like that, except the brokerage offices. And I'd go out and buy what there was called a newspaper at night to get prices. And at Fordham, I had a finance professor who then became the president of Tulane, Eamon Kelly. I then had a couple of other individuals that were accounting professors, and I had marketing, the only guy that gave me a B. Just remember that in the future.
When you want something from Mario.
Yeah, that's it. I took a course with Roger. I had no idea what part of Wall Street I would be. I mean, I wasn't exposed to it. And then with the intensity and the focus and what Lee described, the drilling down and looking at businesses and understanding the business in the context of the environment in which they function and the government and the world economies and the company economies, that's what said, this is what you want to do. So that's what I still do. And it's only 60 years later. By the way, for those from outside the United States, I'm only one-third the age of the country. It made me sound older than I am. And I'm half the age of...
I understand. You're talking, and when you talk to Mario, you're talking to a junkie. He's totally committed to what he does. He works his ass off for his investors. He's a 24/7 kind of person.
So a very quick story.
So that was that's the sun, the moon, and the stars, because I decided that I had to do research with intensity and focus. And I got very lucky. The markets are up 45 times, 35 times. The Dow was 1,000 when I started working, and it's 35,000 today.
And it went from 1,000 to 660 in 2 years, because I remember that distinctly.
And it was 1,000 when I started my firm in 1977. Nobody wanted to own stocks. And 45 years from now, just add your, find out how old you are, figure it out. 45 years from now, in 2067, the market's going to be a million. It's only about an 8% CAGR.
What's the dollar going to be worth?
Yeah, the dollar.
Yeah, that's something else. Let's not get into that. You know, my 5 cent subway token.
That's in real dollars. It'll be a million in real. Yeah. It'll be adjusted for inflation.
Listen, Hong Kong dollars will be, if they, I don't even thought we were around. But go ahead.
All right, so 1992, I find myself at the Breakers on vacation. Mario Gabelli is there. And I don't really know Mario at that point. And it's a beautiful day, just gorgeous day. And we're by the pool. And Mario has a duffel bag full of research reports. A duffel bag, hand, L.L. Bean duffel bag, worn out, full of research reports that he's reading by the side of the pool. He's a junkie.
You know what the problem with guys like you, you have a good memory.
I realized at that point I was never going to be successful.
Oh.
When I was working for you, I would get emails at like 4 in the morning. I'm like, does this guy ever sleep?
Well, I didn't know I knew how to do email. You know, what we do today is artificial intelligence helps you gather information faster. It helps you gather information faster. Instead of me taking a spreadsheet with paper and penciling it in and making sure I had all the numbers right, because if I had to type it, I couldn't make a mistake and retype it. Today, you got to apply the judgment to the data, whether you're talking about IFRS data, but make out you are morally responsible for anyone that entrusts money to you. Make out you're the one that is going to have a responsibility for their success independent of. So you want to calculate that. Then in addition to that, make out you want to own the company. You're buying a piece of the company and make out you want to be the ultimate owner. That's the way our firm thinks.
I think when I started in the business, we had to hand type into that little Excel. I think there was something very valuable to live with the numbers.
You know, I agree with that.
Everyone downloads the numbers and they never spend any time with them.
Yeah, your mind.
I think we now have data overload. When I came into the business, I became the director of research at Goldman. I remember hiring a guy that wanted to cover like 100 companies. And when he retired at the end of the road, this was, I can tell you his name. It's not a bad story, so his name was Joe Ellis. He was a retail analyst at Goldman. When he retired, he was complaining he was covering 5 companies. He complained the workload. There was no 8Ks, no 10Ks, and all that kind of stuff. And we're all overloaded with information now, a lot of which is irrelevant. And you have to separate the wheat from the chaff and figure out what's relevant and make that incisive judgment what's going to move that particular security.
I think we should open it up for questions.
I agree. What a great idea. Questions?
This was strategy.
Trish, you always have a question.
You need a microphone here. I will throw it to you, but thank you.
Thank you. Modern technology, Trish.
Before I ask any question, let me first congratulate our friends Paul Johnson and Paul Sonkin for giving us this book. I think this is a fantastic book. Definitely. And thank you, Mario. Thank you, Lee. Thank you, Jim. We have we have several students of Roger Murray here. Lee, you are a student. Mario, you are a student. Regina, you are a student of Roger Murray. So we think we have people who can speak about how exactly he taught. He was a great teacher, as the book says. There's a lot of gems in this book, and I think everybody should actually see that, appreciate that. But in terms of a question, let me go back to what Jim Kelly was saying just now about balance sheet. And I think one of the things that we are seeing today is this intangible assets in the balance sheet. And so when Roger Murray speaks about value and price and convergence of value and price, now Paul, both Pauls, you have thoroughly researched everything that you have written. Would you be able to tell us how he would have thought and reacted?
Well, back in that era, the issue was
fraudulent. The question is, what you're asking is, how do I look at intangibles on a company's balance sheet versus
intellectual capital.
Intellectual capital.
Yeah. Well, back in that era, it wasn't really an issue at all. The issue was fraudulent accounting. And remember the conglomerates and the dirty pooling and Gulf and Western, Charlie Bluedorn, all these names. And that's where I think the focus was when you looked at the balance sheet, as opposed to intangibles, which have become dominant in the last recent decades.
I think that part of the reason that Roger was so focused on ratio analysis, particularly over a long period of time, was just that, an earnings quality issue.
Yeah.
It's in any given year, it's fairly easy to mask something, but over time, it's really hard to mask it. I think that was one of the things. And he was ahead of his time. The whole unaccountable accounting doesn't happen until late in his teaching career. So he's very early on recognizing that.
The problem for the current investor, given the increase in technology, is technology, double-edged sword. Somebody's innovation is somebody's obsolescence. My first job at a Hunter College, I went to work for Xerox, where they put the American Photocopy out of business. And then the Japanese have knocked off Xerox to the point where it's just an 8-multiple stock with lots of competition. You know, so, you know, technology is a plus, very exciting, but the truth of the matter is we're innovating at such a rapid pace. Look what's happened to Facebook, where TikTok has really presented a big problem for them. You know, and so you got to be very, product cycles are shorter, innovation is greater, and, you know, when you pay a high multiple of something, you're assuming it's going to be a sustainable growth rate for a long period of time, and that's the risk, and you got to do what you're comfortable doing.
Yeah, let me try to answer your question directly. Roger really innovated on Ben Graham, as he did, because the world changed. And then Bruce, who we mentioned up front, Bruce really innovated on what Roger did. And I think it's Bruce's work really around scale and barriers to entry that come into intangibles. You can't value them in the balance sheet sense like we would in the old days, but where you see that captured is in customer captivity. Mm-hmm. And I have to give Bruce, I think Bruce did more about around that than ever before. I think Roger would have struggled with intangibles for a while. And you needed an innovation like the way Bruce came at it.
Questions? There we go, right
David,
here.
David, you're up.
Well, I see a student first, but you're going to be a student. Yeah, come on, give it to the student first. Three rows up on your left. Throw it to him.
So you mentioned that we know a lot more now than you did when you entered the industry. Do you think there's any competencies that we lack that you might have had that
The question was the following. When we entered the industry, to get a job back in 1900X, I had to take psychological exams to get past the HR department.
How did you get hired?
That's a problem. They turned me down.
The
only reason I got hired was I caddied for a guy, and he knew the senior partner at Loeb Rhodes, and he said, this is a very focused individual. No, that's not true. Lee would have hired me. I don't think there's anything different today with you. The only thing that Lee had, he called it poor, hungry, and driven. I call it passionate, hungry, and driven. And so to the degree that that's what your focus is on your career and keep the options open for your career, that is the golden bell for you because you're going to do it. And so many people will tell you not to do it. In 1977, when I started the firm, the headlines were the death of equities. What are you, starting a brokerage firm when everybody's going out of business? They would have said you wouldn't make it. They were right.
Not really.
I would just.
But I don't know if that answers your question. Lee, you want to add and hitchhike on that?
I couldn't. What, repeat the question.
The question was, what is different today in order to succeed? You want to echo it, and I'll repeat it again?
It's 3 yards and a cloud of dust. It's hard work. It's commitment. And the thing that worries me is the decline of the Western civilization. We don't have the same work ethic we had back then. I think the Wall Street Journal had a story on it today or yesterday where they said the people don't want to work for their success. And I say, emulate my work ethic, not my, don't envy my income, you know, envy my work ethic.
I spend more time in the classroom than these very successful businessmen, and I will just tell you, their fathers were very concerned about the work ethic then. So that has just been around for a while. Don't get too worked up.
My father came to America at the age of 12 as a plumber's apprentice. He had no education, understood the importance of education, and he put bread at the table, and he created a successful family. Mario's dad was a chef and provided for the family and emphasized the importance of education. And Mario excelled at Fordham, and he excelled at Columbia Business School.
And they had to walk home uphill both ways.
Let me just add one more thing.
Yeah, please.
What I see among my students in general is they don't have patience. They suffer from ADD. They get so much input from all of the social media, constantly checking back and forth. Everything is so immediate that they really don't take time to reflect and think about things in a longer term perspective.
We know Ben Graham and Graham Newman as a fund. Did Roger Murray manage money? If so, how did he do? Did he outsource it to any of these gentlemen?
It's the great question. Let me repeat the question. So Ben Graham was a true practitioner and was the first hedge fund. We don't give him credit for that, but he ran a hedge fund called Graham Newman for 28 years. And so the question really is did Roger manage money? And he managed money internally at Bankers Trust, and he was really senior. He was there for 24 years. He managed money probably for 12 of the 24. And then he was at CREF for 6 years where he helped manage the portfolio. And in doing the research, we could not find any track records on performance. And he was part of bigger institutions, so it's not surprising. He didn't have direct clients that way. But when he went to CREF the first year, they had $50 million under management. And
it shows you how smart he was.
I'm sorry?
It shows you how smart he was. He stayed away from the risky part of the business.
Exactly. And by the time he left, the portfolio had $950 million in it. So.
He pounded the table for equities in the early 70s.
Well, he was a true believer in America and a true believer in common stock. And he thought that the perceived risk of common stocks, particularly among savings and loans and traditional institutions, was way over concern. And at any opportunity, he told people they should be buying stocks. He was a permanent bull that way. And he was right.
I remember him telling a story, and this is 1965. Where he had a student that graduated, one of his early students, and the student was very negative about the market right before the 62 break. And he bumped into the student walking in the street and he said, "Congratulations, you made a very prescient call." And the student said to the professor, "I can't accept your congratulations. I had a portfolio of special situations," which turned out to be not so special. But he understood the game. He understood the game.
Question here.
I'm wondering if you would mind speculating on what a value investor like Roger Murray, or indeed yourselves, think about the current fad of ESGness.
There's an easy topic, ESG.
I am totally in favor of anything anybody wants, whether you want to buy gambling in Macau, defense companies, or finding an alternative to energy. If we were in this, Roger Murray, and I was at Fordham, there was a steamy movie. May have been rated careful. It's called The Graduate. And in The Graduate, there's a scene with Dustin Hoffman. Dustin Hoffman goes...
Plastics.
He said, the guy says to him, there's a great future in plastic. Well, today, there's a great future in controlling plastics in the world. Not rigid, but the other stuff. So the world changes, and you have to adapt, and we need to adjust. We still have lead in the pipelines, even though the Romans had problems 1,800 years ago. We've got to figure it out. Lee, you want to add to that? And that is, talk about ESG investing. Talk about ESG.
I'm ignorant to that stuff. I'm investing with companies that hopefully are well-managed and abide by the law. I don't like going into, you know, specialty-type funds that are only, you know, tobacco or healthcare. I want to be with a money manager that has the flexibility to go where he should be going. And I don't want to be relegated to any one area.
I'm
not a fan of ESG investing. I'm a fan of investing with companies that obey the law. You know, and I think a big problem we're running into now is there's no appreciation of capitalism. Look at the criticism of Chevron for the $75 billion buyback. Nobody wants to talk about it. They've for 100 years invested in hydrocarbons and developed the reserves that are so vital now. You know, there's just a very negative view. You're dealing with leadership positions that don't understand the government, that don't understand the world. I had my to-do with Elizabeth Warren recently.
Thank you.
to answer your question,
please.
It depends on which part of ESG. Roger was a very progressive when it came to social issues.
Yeah.
When he was at Kraft, he managed money for teachers, and he said, and it said a lot often, that he knew that he had to represent his constituents. And they were teachers, and teachers were very worried about many things. And that permeated his investment style. And he was very aggressive on particularly governance way before his time. He was particularly sensitive to executive compensation. He thought egregious executive compensation was unnecessary, and he fought against that. And any company, as Lee would say, anything that they felt were breaking the law or right at the edge of the law or pushing it, he was very aggressive. He owned the stock. He acted like a shareholder. He would go to the annual meeting, and he would be very aggressive. He would write letters.
Eastman Kodak example. Yeah. He went up to the annual meeting of Eastman Kodak and made a public statement that they should hire more minorities.
Yeah, so particularly being in Rochester, his thought was, you're in Rochester, your employee base does not represent the population of the community, and he was very aggressive. So I think he would, ESG is a very complicated, but I think in the spirit of it, he would have been 100% supportive.
Yeah.
Other question? Oh, we have a couple of students up here. Maybe.
Yeah.
Younger people.
You can follow up questions if you want. And just have questions prepared. I'll call on you otherwise. All right, I won't.
So with the financial markets innovating and changing at a pace that hasn't been seen before, how will value investing evolve to cope with the acceleration in the market cycles?
I'll take a crack at it. I'd love you and Lee to talk about
it. Again.
The question is given the market cycles and the inundation of information, how does value investing evolve in the current market? We've got to go back to sort of the definition. Definition is pretty simple. There is an intrinsic value, a fundamental value to the underlying asset or company. And then price is a reflection. It's a market's estimate of that value. And it's clear that market prices are way more volatile than the underlying fundamental value. And therefore, if you have a good sense, certainly what Graham said, Murray would say, if you had a sense of that fundamental value, you could take advantage of those price volatilities. And it's that simple. Now, if you don't have a good sense of the fundamental value, or you're really dictated by changes in price, which Lee has referred to a couple of times, you have no chance. If you're just trying to outguess price, you have no chance. But if you do have a sense of value, and as Mario said a couple of times, you think ahead, you think, what does this company look like in 5 years? What's their profitability? What's their market position? What would that be worth? Then you can look back now, you can take advantage of the price volatility. So the fundamentals haven't changed. Gyrations may have changed. We have more volatility. But if you're diehard, you're doing the work, potentially that would be create more opportunity. But as Jim said, you gotta be patient. This isn't gonna happen overnight. As Mario said, you gotta be able to think beyond the next investor. And as Lee said, you really have to understand the company, the fundamentals and management.
Well, I think that one way that value investing has changed is that people aren't as patient and you have activists that are unlocking value. And we have someone sitting on this panel that I think files more 13Ds than anyone else.
Is that you, Jim?
I assume that answer gave you a question. Mark, you want to add to that?
Well, no, the only, basically, back in the 70s, when I started the firm, I had to pay bills. And nobody wanted to buy stocks. So I came up with the idea that if a company is public, how do I value it? How do I value it if somebody can take it and take it from being public to being private? So we created what we call the private market value of companies. The difference today is that a 10-year govy today is 3.55 today at the close. Then a 10-year govy was, I think it got up to 14.78 somewhere in the late 90s.
Late 1970s.
So, you had different dynamics. A very simple approach that we take is, if you can buy a company today at a 7 multiple of EBITDA minus CapEx, and you can sell it at seven times, what are my interest rates that I have to pay down the road at the time? What's my capital structure, and how much can I earn on my equity on the premise the company had no growth, but just cash generated? Or if it could grow at 2 or 4 or 6%. And what would happen if inflation picked up and has their pricing power? So you do a lot of these little simple things. They're easy to do. You just have to think it through, and you got to be patient. 45 years from now, 1 million on the Dow. 1 million. And you're not even going to be my age, most of you.
Oh, we've got a couple more right here.
Yeah, please. Fast. This is we got another one on the side there as well.
Thank you. Hi. First of all, I would like to thank all the speakers for all these amazing insights. My question is to you, Mr. Gabelli and Mr. Cooperman, that what are your thoughts on buying 50 cent a dollar versus buying reasonably good investments at a reasonable price? The concern that I have in buying net or 50 cent a dollar stock is that for the time I'm waiting for them to realize the value, if something happens to the business or management and there is another issue happens that I have to worry about, and my initial hypothesis goes away. How do you answer this question in the context of a young investor who is working with a small sum of money, and where should they go for fishing? Long-term compounders or net or everything?
Good, do it. Lee, did you get the question? If I'm buying 50 cents, it's the
cash. You gotta go where you're comfortable. You gotta go where you're comfortable. You know, basically, you don't. If you buy something outside of your sphere of capability and something you don't feel comfortable with, the moment you have a bad day, you're gonna sell it. You know, and maybe you should want to buy more. You know, not sell it. And so I think you have to go where you're comfortable, where you have an understanding. You know, Buffett has said publicly he doesn't feel comfortable with technology, but he found Apple, made, I think it's a big chunk of the value of his company now is his success in Apple. You got to go where your knowledge base carries you and where your comfort level carries you. And that's the most important thing to me. I like buying a dollar bill for 50, 60, 70, or 80 cents. I like low multiple stocks. I like companies that buy back stock. I think Congress is idiotic by putting a tax on buybacks. You know, just another use of capital. You value a management and their buyback decisions no different than their capital investment decisions or their acquisition decisions or whatever. It's another financial strategy. And what the government can understand is when Chevron buys back $75 billion worth of stock, somebody is likely selling it to them that has a large capital gains to pay taxes on those gains. And when they pay dividends, the people pay tax on the dividends. I don't think they understand the capitalistic system.
Yeah, let me hitchhike on that a little more, because back in the 70s when I started the firm and I had to pay bills, which I still do, but at that time it was more important. The notion of making money and worrying about the value trap, so to speak, I added the element of what is the catalyst? What is visible in government changes, in company changes, in the management changes, in the company structure, and in industry consolidation, so that we could realize that return in 2 or 3 years? Today, at that time, you had bootstrap financing. It then became leveraged buyouts. Then it became, what did Milken call it? LBOs, right? And there was something else in between. And then today it's private equity. So how do you, if you own enough of the company, not individually, but collectively, you file a 13D and it gets some visibility and you can tell managements. Now, we make mistakes. I mean, we have a company that the world changed. They were offering equipment to allow people to do self-checkouts. Well, the last 2 years in places like New York City, this checkouts really turned on the word self. And so the company has not done as well. What?
I wanted to add something. I just lost the thought, but just bear with me 1 second.
You'll bounce it back. We're going to have one question, two to the right, just past the microphone. You got it? You can yell it out and somebody will repeat it. No, all the way up.
Right here. This works.
Okay, we got that one, and then just toss it back. There you go. Thank you.
Thanks. It's an open question, but mainly to Mario and Lee, who were sort of day-to-day practitioners. Do you apply the principles of value investing as learned as rigorously, as consistently, as much on your sell decisions as you do on the buys?
Sell versus buy.
Yeah, Lee, the question is, given what you learned with Graham and Dodd and Roger Murray,
I heard the question. I would say I sell a stock for one of four reasons when I was in business. Number one, when I buy a stock, I identify a price objective. If nothing changes and appreciates that price objective, I'll sell it. Second reason I sell a stock basically is, you know, I find an idea that has a better risk reward profile. I'm not the Federal Reserve Board, I can't print money. So I sell one stock to buy another stock that has a more appealing ratio of reward to risk. Third reason I sell a stock basically is I track it and things are not unfolding the way I thought they would unfold, and I sell it before I get destroyed. The fourth reason I sell a stock is I change my view of the market and I want to become more defensive. Now, going back to the prior question, what I was going to say is basically Warren Buffett about 40 years ago gave an analysis in his annual report. It was somewhat skewed, but he showed what you would have in the way of asset value if you bought and held a 15% serial compounder as opposed, say, for 40 years, as opposed to buying that year's hot stock, making 15%, selling it, paying the taxes, reinvesting the money. And you had thousands of times more money. So I'd say the best way for you to accumulate wealth is be a long-term investor. Long-term capital gains are a tax preference item. It's the best way to accumulate wealth other than inheriting it. So assuming you're not in store to inherit a lot of money, I'd say be a long-term investor. That's the best way to accumulate wealth. And get an education like you're working on right now, because you know your education will increase your value.
Yeah, let me give you the math on that. If you, if I have a client that's taxable and you live in New York City and you have a stock that goes from 10 to 50, and because of a spike on emotions, like on a day like today, and you think it's probably worth 40, the client will pay a tax of 40%, assuming it's long-term, it's 23.8%, a non-deductible 15% to the city. He's gonna pay, whether it's crypto or whatever, you gotta pay a tax, and therefore, am I better off waiting for that stock's intrinsic value to catch up? So those are the things we think about. On the other side of the coin, the best one is a takeover. So you pray for lightning to strike your stocks and have it taken over so that you don't have a voluntary decision. Yeah, please, right here.
You get your mic back.
You get the mic back, and then give the other one right here. Load and reload.
Give it to Henry. All right, you go ahead.
Okay, go.
We hear a lot about disruption nowadays, and I'd be really curious, how do you foresee the rate of change of disruption increasing or not in our future? And do you foresee that actually having a structural change in the way that it has in the past, where it's created new industry, created new jobs, or is there a more pessimistic outlook in that respect?
The question is, what Lee talked about, creative innovation. I don't look at Schumpeter as creative destruction, even though they call it that. I look at it creative innovation. I think the notion of me not having to wait for an elevator operator is pretty good. I don't like waiting for the tolls. That's pretty good. Those jobs are being destroyed. If I'm a farmer and I can have 40,000 acres and I can monitor them from home in the wintertime or something else, and I can precisely plant seed, weed, and fertilizer and save on water, that's pretty good. And the notion of the Luddites in England in the 1840s when they attacked them because they were going to create equipment to destroy jobs, you know, hopefully we as a country and the world come up with more opportunities to find new jobs to replace the old ones. So I'm a very bullish on the dynamics of the free market system. Lee and I went down.
As long as we remain a free market.
But you and I went down to Cuba and you can see where they try to centrally control an economy and misallocated resources. When I was in Budapest the first time right after the Berlin Wall came down, you know, I said, where's your problem? They couldn't get phones. And the Russians were building a steel mill up the Danube. The free market, with all the faults, will help that allocation.
The pace of technological innovation is going to accelerate.
Exactly.
The major
exactly.
risk is that the 30% of the young kids today think socialism is preferred to capitalism. And that's a threat. That's a big threat. You know, they're trying to break up these big technology companies. I think that Microsoft and Google have done more for the world than most any other company.
Yeah, but we've survived that before, Lee. They broke up AT&T, Ma Bell. They broke up IBM. They broke up a whole bunch of companies.
AT&T service is terrible today.
Well, I know you own T-Mobile, so that's why you're pitching it.
I was at Berkeley in the 70s. Trust me, we've been through this cycle before.
Yeah.
All right, Henry, go ahead.
Great. Thanks, Paul. So both Mario and Leon has similar kind of training and similar kind of growing up in that kind of range in the 60s from CBS. Both were very successful. You got similar kind of training. But maybe, you know, smart people can have differences, right? But if there is one thing that both of you have contrast in style, what would that be?
Lee was smart and he went to work for Goldman Sachs.
You did okay.
You did okay.
Not like Lee, though.
No. But what's the question?
What is the thing that you did smarter than me? And I said you went to work for Goldman Sachs.
I think that the only thing that's changed about you is the color of your hair. When I knew you, you were a redhead. Now you got a full head of white hair. And you're the same weight you were when you were at Columbia Business School.
It's shifted a little.
You know, but basically, I will tell you, look to your left, look to your right. You're going to make some friendships in school. You're going to keep the rest of your life. And you're going to get some initials after your name that you're going to have the rest of your life. And hopefully get an education that will make you more competitive in the world. And there's lots of ways of skinning a cat. You know, you just got to do it the way you're comfortable. And you got to have a longer term vision. You can't be short-term oriented. I could have left Goldman Sachs a number of occasions before I was a partner, but I decided to stick it out. And then when I became a partner, nobody could afford to hire me. You know, I was very lucky.
I guess we have time for two more questions.
One, two, and that's it.
In the back there, just ask, right over here.
Rapid fire, one all the way in the back.
Where's the other mic?
Come on, you can stand up and please.
Stand up?
No, you don't have to. You don't have to. That's fine.
Okay. I'm curious. I'm sure you guys have had this experience in your careers. How do you balance looking at two companies? One is it's a value company, but the other company is a high-quality company, but it's trading at a very high multiple. Mm-hmm. So how do you balance your value investment process and looking at another company that is not trading at low multiple, but is a high quality company?
That's a great question, and I'm glad you asked it, Lee.
I really don't engage in that debate, because if somebody owns it, they think it's value. They don't own it, they think it's something else. So basically, I look at the growth rate versus the multiple I'm paying, my confidence in the growth rate, the projectability of that growth rate, the free cash flow that they're generating and how they're using that cash, and their industry position. But, you know, Google sells at 17 times earnings. That's not a growth multiple. You know, it's a growth company with a fortress balance sheet. You can't generalize. I tend to look very bottom up. The smartest guy I ever dealt with was Dr. Henry Singleton. When I went in, it was value. At the end of the road, it wasn't value, it was growth. But he was the smartest guy.
And this is what we learned from Roger Murray, what Warren Buffett would write in his annual reports, what you learned from Bruce Greenwald, what you would have learned from Ben Graham and David Dodd, and what you're learning now from Jim Kelly. And that is basically, I like growth companies. I don't like them where there's cash burn and very negative cash flow in an environment where there's volatility in the source of capital. I like to control my outcomes. So that's the way I look at businesses. Okay, and as a result of that, what Lee indicated, there are some very attractive growth companies with good growth dynamics, but they have the positive cash flow because of low CapEx. They have a moat around the business that allows them to have recurring revenue. You know, if I sell cars, that's one thing. If I sell subscription revenues, for example, you know, if you're buying Spotify and you're listening to music and you could afford $10, you know, that's a very good business. And then you look at companies that supply Spotify, and if they have a positive balance sheet and they're growing because they're tied on to Spotify, you know, we know how to value that. And so that's a good question, but, you know, I just don't look at
it. A lot of it has to do with the macro picture.
Let me give you an example. Yeah. I went back and looked at 1972 Nifty 50. Back in 1972, which is not exactly ancient history, the investment game was run by J.P. Morgan and U.S. Trust. And their philosophy was only the right company at any price. They didn't care about what they paid. So let me give you some examples. Avon, 65 times earnings. Dow Chemical, 25 times earnings. This is 72. Eastman Kodak, 48 times earnings. GE, 26. IBM, 37. Kmart went bankrupt, 34 times earnings. Back in 1972, the 10-year U.S. government was 6.5%, and T-bills yielded 4.6%. In today's environment, there's nothing that's overvalued at today's interest rates. The question you got to make a judgment on is, are interest rates reasonable? I think they're not, you know, but who the hell knows? I'm in a minority opinion. You know, prior to the great financial crisis, the 10-year U.S. government bond yielded in line with nominal GDP. Now, nominal GDP is running, I don't know, 6, 7%, and the 10-year government's 3.5%. So something's got to change.
You want to cut it?
The investment business one is more. A fashion business.
We technically have two more because we've given them
all right, go ahead, do it. And then we're outside for as many as you want, and I'll give you Lee's home phone number and his private cell.
Tonight is poker night, Mario. You got to call me before 7.
Real quick, just you touch upon the use of artificial intelligence to get data. How much are you using artificial intelligence or will be used to get investment decisions?
Gathering the data, arraying the data, projecting the data, interpreting it, and communicating is our mantra. To gather the data, AI is very important. Okay, because I remember having to go to the New York Stock Exchange and microfiche. Today you hit a button, I want the earnings conference call today for Oshkosh. Bingo, I get it right away. Okay, we get that. I couldn't be on that conference call because I was on another conference call. I have 40 analysts, 20 portfolio managers around the world, and we need to synchronize that. I want the guy in Hong Kong to be on the same call, and it's right now it would be 6 in the morning, so he should be up. Meanwhile, the guy in London is, what is it now, midnight. So we try to coordinate everything, and we use all the technology we can. And then the question is, what do we do with it? And so we do not allow the markets to make judgments on price based on, you know, the stock market, what it does today. I don't know if that helps, but if it doesn't, you can see me later.
Last question, go ahead.
Earlier, you guys, in a response to another question, said that today, students today and young people lack patience, which people have had in the past. I'm just wondering what your advice is for us current students in keeping in the moment and having the patience to work to success.
I'd say advice to the young kids today. Any advice? Plastics?
Yeah. No, the advice is an industry to go into?
No, I think if you wanted to pursue this career?
Basically, the first thing you should do is play cards and learn how to lose. Make sure you want to be in this business. Make sure you want to help people make money. Make sure you want
to
be.
Back to the question I made. Do what you love, love what you do.
Yeah, he said it well. I can't echo anything, but for you to start, I'd want you to borrow $2 and buy a baseball team. You can buy a piece of the Atlanta Braves and see if you like that. Go into the stock market. Berkshire Hathaway's annual report. Read what you're writing here and some of the things that these professors will tell you about. And applaud me when I applaud those that wrote about value investing and brought it to Fordham and are promulgating it.
Let me add one thing to that. We talked about Mario being a junkie, Lee's a junkie. You're competing against junkies. So if you don't love it as much as they do, you lose.
No, but
well, yes. Yes.
Not everyone is going to be like Lee and as successful as he was. I mean, and then gives it all back to society. Like he mentioned, this guy at Langone. Yeah. So, do your own thing. Just create your own options. Just be flexible and say, I can't say it in public. You want to
get a good education with good grades. Start out that way. Get a good education.
I wish it was that easy. All right, we start. I like Lee's advice.
Well, okay, I'll tell you what it was. Lee grew up in a rich part of the Bronx. I grew up in a poor section. Moved to the Bronx.
Just the reverse, just the reverse. You know, I grew up in the section where, if you saw the movie Ford Apache, the Bronx, the opening scene was two kids threw a third kid off the rooftop of a building six stories up.
I've taught you how to run, I know.
That's exactly where I grew up. But I went to Morris High School. I went back recently. When I went to the high school, it was 50% of color. Today, it's 100% of color. But I had a very good time at school. I enjoyed it, and I went back. And the sad thing, when I went back, I had to go through a metal detector device with three armed guards. And that's high schools today in the school. And it's a very sad situation.
All right. It's a very,
on that positive
wait,
note.
Wait, we started with a quote. We started with a Murray quote. We're going to end with a Murray quote.
You know, I have to commend the faculty and the administration at Fordham, and thanks to Tanya and Luzerne and all of the Therese and everybody else, and thank you, Jim Kelly, and thank you, Paul and...
Paul,
what?
Paul and Paul, we keep it simple.
Who, PP?
All right, I'm gonna read this quote, even though I know you want to quit. All right, this is from Roger Murray. The name of the course doesn't matter. A teacher's job is to encourage, stimulate, and if necessary, belabor the students to be curious, questioning, and to develop a facility for analyzing and interpret financial results. If you can bring in illustrations to the classroom, the more current, the better. It brings these things to life. So we hope today we channeled Roger Murray and we gave you a little bit of an education. So thank you for coming.
Appreciate it. Thank you.